Welcome, everyone. I'm Brian Germain, and this is Casual Chat Live, and I've got one of my oldest, best skydiving friends right here, Tony Uragallo. Welcome, Tony.
Hello, everybody.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah. So basically, I mean, the whole idea with Casual Chat is to try to share awesome people with the skydiving world, and Tony, you're awesome.
Ah, thank you.
You are. So basically, I mean, I want to just sort of, because some people might know who you are. Other people are like, Tony Uragallo, who's that? And I say, you know, Tony Suits. They go, oh, Tony Suits. They might not know your last name, but but you've been skydiving a crazy long amount of time, right? How many years have you been jumping?
72, I started skydiving. 1970, I started military jumping.
Yeah.
But once I started skydiving, that was enough of that.
Yeah. So I mean, I met you in, I want to say 80, I don't know, maybe 87 or something.
Okay, I remember the years.
I don't remember exactly, but at some point along the lines, maybe it was 88, at some point you said, here, you want to try this new thing, it's called the Jonathan. And you hooked me up with this prototype. It wasn't even a regular Jonathan, it was a tricell. I don't know if you remember the tricell Jonathan.
In the ends?
Yeah. It was on the ends, and it was phenomenal. It blew my mind. There was nothing, and of course, this was first elliptical canopy, right?
Well, Kintail had one, and Blue Track had one, but they were different. They got longer in the middle and shorter the ends. But mine was the first with the parallel center sail, and then reducing at the ends.
Yeah, and it was curved, you know, and it wasn't sort of blocky. It was a nice, you know, fairly smooth. Yeah.
And then I remember you just saying, I got this airlock idea. And I said, yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, remember that? You were having your, you always used to do a really great Thanksgiving Day party at the shop. Okay. And I came over with my miniature prototype. And I took you outside and you were running in a circle, spinning it around, looking at the airlock to see how it inflated. You're like, do you want a job? Funny you should mention. Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, I mean, the rest was history. But we did a lot of really cool things over the years.
Yeah, that was a fun time, especially doing the free flying with the X Games.
And that was awesome.
Free flying going and then the parachute. That was a good time.
Yeah, well, and thanks to Pete McKeeman, right, for making that whole thing work.
Pete McKeeman, the X Games.
Yeah. That was amazing.
Some videos the other day of us free flying.
I'd like to find more. I don't know if you've got any.
No, I haven't seen any of that stuff ever. People didn't know I was a free flyer, you know.
It was absolutely astounding. The this was new. I mean, nobody was doing it.
What year was the free flying? Do you remember? Which was the same as the parachute, of course.
Yeah, well,
I did it with Jim O'Reilly, but that was super at the beginning.
Yeah, well, that was back in these days.
Yeah. Right? I asked Olaf what he wants to call it. I saw Olaf flying head down.
Yeah.
And I wanted to make that movie of our sip flying, we were only sip flying. And I saw his stuff and went, wow, look at that. You're flying in your head. Yeah. What are you calling this? He said, free flying. So I did that, 3D flying, and did the ad of me and Jim sip flying and said, free flying, the way of the future. So I snuck in before Olaf to call it free flying.
You did. You released your video before the Chronicles, didn't you?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beat him to the punch. But yeah, this is picture of Jim O'Reilly, who's, I think, out of the game right now, but on the bottom.
I've been trying to find him.
Walking all over Jim-O.
If anybody knows where he is, tell him to contact me.
What a good man, right? Mm-hmm. And that dude was always smiling, always having a good time. He had it figured out.
Yeah, he was. Someone told me a story of someone driving with him, and he was driving a car, and he was playing a washboard the whole time.
He loved his washboard.
He said he never stopped. The whole drive, he played this thing for hours and hours. It wasn't just a little thing. That was typical, Jim.
Yeah, it was probably Devin, right? these are monumental times because everybody was flat flying. That's all there was. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, the sit suit, I think, was a huge step forward, which was, I guess, the concept was it Dale Stewart?
Yeah, she started with a freestyle wing. She had a little wing. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, man, you could use that for zip flying. Because I was trying the French wing, which is now a camera suit. And I thought it was hard work with a thumb loop.
Yeah, that was one thing in the front.
Dale Stewart did her thing, and I said, I'll try it with a bigger wing. And I went, wow, this is easy.
Yeah.
So I went all over the place showing people how to zip fly. And then obviously it went head down, and that was the end of that.
If you remember, we actually did compete together at the X Games stuff with the back of your suits. Remember the checkerboard? It was like purple and white.
Right.
It had sit wings and the back of your legs. So we did, there was a time where there was kind of an overlap, and we did, I think the sit stuff that we did back in those days with the wings was more precise than what you see even now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the sit wings are nice.
You used to go head down. When you go in the head down, you go faster. You were the only one, I remember, that didn't speed up when you went head down.
No, I'm flexible.
But I always dropped out the sky when I
went. Well, you just go to a stand-up. I could stay with you. Yeah, it was fun creating it, you know. We'd sit around and we'd go, all right, I wonder if we can – I don't know if it'll work, but, you know, what the hell. Let's risk it for a biscuit.
Moves. Yeah, that was very exciting. And then going back to work on the parachute.
I like how it overlapped.
That came out.
Yeah, we'd run out to the drop zone in Z Hills and go to 7 grand, jam out some quick free flying, and dump our prototypes.
Uh-huh. That was a good time, definitely, over across town. And in the video you just sent me, we had Tomcats. I wish we had Jonathans or Jedis. Why didn't we have Jedis in those pictures?
In pictures, or the little video?
The video you showed me, sent me.
Those were
baggy suits, landing sit suits.
Yeah, you know, the canopies that we were flying in the end, those were not Tomcats.
Oh.
Those were Jedis.
Oh.
I was trying to remember, though, if they were the swept wing version or the regular one, and I don't have those canopies.
I thought they were.
I would guess that those were swept wings. Because
I don't remember us ever having Team Tomcat.
I never had a Tomcat. I tested.
Oh, all right. I need to go look at it again.
No, the Tomcat actually was a heck of a parachute. I mean, compared to the Sabre, I liked it a lot more.
Ah, thank you.
I did. It was faster.
Someone said I need to upgrade my camera. Epic.
Yes, exactly. Your camera is a little bit grainy.
I think it's because it's not enough light.
Could be.
I bet you if I went, but you don't want a lot of light on me.
Some things you just don't want to see.
I should just move it back a bit. There you go. Is that better?
Yeah, it's good. It's good. Yeah, just make sure your eyes are framed 1/3 down from the top. You know. So we have some good questions that came in. One of them, look at this. Oh, somebody's commenting that he, Tony, you might not remember me, but you created my first Tony suit at Skyfest in Houston in 2007. That's kind of cool. We get a lot of people like that are like, oh yeah, Tony made my suit. Wait, I mean, you made my pit special for me in the 80s, and it was like late 80s, and it was hands down the most beautiful suit anybody had ever seen. It got stolen from the brand.
People have to remind me.
I mean, it was amazing. Yeah. The original, actually, you know what I think about it? It wasn't a pit special. What did you call the one before that? That had the nice, like, pinstriping down the arms. It had grippers.
No, it was a Tony suit, just a regular Tony suit.
It was called the Tony suit, yeah.
The Tony suit, because that was the only one. The pit special was the first time, I think, that I branched away from the regular just Tony suit, just a loose suit.
Yes, I suppose, yeah. Okay. Well, one of the things I've always admired is that you're not, you don't make suits just because, you know, the function has to be this drag and whatever. You always add this creative flair or you'd make the thing look beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of the design with the pinstriping, the piping.
The sky and you got cameras everywhere. You want to bring it all up. If everybody wears black, it's kind of boring, isn't it? You know? So,
well, I think we're battling that. Aren't we? We're battling black. There's too much of it.
You probably don't remember Bounce and Blend. Everybody had.
Oh, yeah.
brown and browns and tans, everybody.
I remember it, and we had just a couple color patterns available from Paraflate, right? That was for a canopy.
I saw that. No one's done that in years. Like,
yeah. Well, I think about bringing it back. I mean, making canopies, it's always something different. They want one green rib or whatever. It'd be nice to just have, here's, you know, three or four options. That's it. I'm just going to buy a few bolts of
color. Orange with fluorescent yellow with lime green. And it's gone totally wild. But I bet you, if I made the old tan, brown, white, yellow.
You could start a trend. Bring it back. What's old is new.
If you do it the wingsuit, you disappear. If you do a big way, I've done a big way in a tan suit, and you go along the ground, and you can see yourself, and you disappear, and you come back, and you disappear, and you come back as the ground changes color. Watch out for camouflage.
Not ideal. Yeah, you want to be seen. Well, to me, a wingsuit is like a canopy. You want to show up. It's a safety issue. Uh-huh. You know, bright, cheery colors for sure. Mm-hmm. And to me, black doesn't show up unless you're in the clouds. It doesn't show up well. And it's hot, right?
Sorry, I was reading.
And somebody had there was a couple questions. About one of them was the wingsuit design process. How do you go about, you've never built a wingsuit before. All you've ever done is jumpsuits. And
at the beginning, Jeff, most of the ideas and draw the lines. He just drew lines and then I made it. You know, I figured it out how to do it and we sewed it up. And then when he went to Sebastian, I started doing that more on my own. And mostly you just change the last suit just a half inch here and a half inch there, you know? Yeah. Too big a change.
Yeah, make it.
Sometimes you do. Then the Apache was a big change.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and people still rave about the Rebel.
The Rebel? Yeah.
For going up. That's what people say. That's the best suit. I don't know if you have an opinion about this, but I like to get airspeed, flare out and go up over clouds. Which is
more? It's not. I stopped working on the Rebel. We got the Rebel Freebird, but no, I got it going a lot faster. I'm going smaller now. If anything, bigger ribs on the floatier suits. Mm-hmm. You know, big deep ribs, big flat wing like a biplane kind of wing, and then right now I'm liking the Nala. It's a faster suit. And all the others seem boring after flying that around the sky. Now,
what do you call that one?
Nala.
The Nala.
And, it's a love story. And, it's so much fun compared with some of the other suits.
Yeah.
People are loving it immediately and find it easier to fly. And so, right into that, I jumped it yesterday. And just loved it. Had the best time with Travis racing. He's the fastest guy in the world, Travis, at speed, you know.
Yeah.
Then he's trying to film me. And I was trying to beat his ass, right? I wanted to get down so he couldn't keep up with me in this suit. So we looked at GPS, and I did have the fastest speed, although it wasn't by much.
Interesting.
He's filmed me, you know. When you got a cameraman, they can never keep up. If they're trying to film you, it's so hard, and me and Nebokov used to do it all the time. We switch suits, and he'd film me in that suit, and I'd leave him behind, and then we change suits, and I'd leave him behind again. It was easy. Robbie didn't film me, of course, but he stayed easy. So the camera makes a big difference when you're trying to film someone. You've got your head up, not getting it down. You know, you got to get on it a bit with the shoulders and your head.
Performance. Well, maybe mounting the camera differently, you know, or putting it in a different spot, different angle, you know, so that the head is, right? They say chin forward, right?
Back of your helmet.
Yeah.
A little, camera loop,
Interesting. That's
the easy part is the ideas for a wingsuit. Then you got to make it, then you got to test it, then you got to decide whether you think it's better or the hardest part. Well, is deciding that wasn't right and then making a change when you land or on the canopy, you're thinking this is that and this is that. And do you need to change it? And do you add a half inch or do you take half inch off? Do you increase the arm sweep, the width of the legs, the depth of the cell?
Yeah.
A thousand things you can do, and you have to guess what to try. And you go back to the shop and you make another set of patterns. And now it's all with computers, of course. But you basically got to go out and try it.
Yeah, which, I mean, I'm sure you've had some sketchy moments with suits that, you know, wanting to stall or
spin. Yeah, I don't mind that so much. Yeah, they don't flare. As soon as you flare it to pull, your speed, you flare to pull and it just stalls.
Yeah.
You give that a few goes and you just give up and you just put your arms back, try to get your legs in or something. Stop forwards for the pull, and that always works out. It's no biggie. The worst ones really was when I took the wing to the toes, like Phoenix I do now.
Yeah.
And I made a tracking suit. My legs were yawing all over the place. High on that and high when I took the wing to toes years ago. Phoenix I did it now, and they put the fins on, I think, to stop that yawing.
A little rudder.
I'm guessing. I've never talked to Robbie about it. We chat about stuff, but he put those fins on. You seen the fins on the Phoenix Fly suit? Those carbon fins?
I have. It looks,
I think that's just
complicated. But it's like you did, remember, with the Jonathan, with the inboard stabilizers, right?
This is elliptical. And everybody, that's why it's called Jonathan, because everybody said, why are you doing this? Why are you doing that? What's wrong with a rectangle? I don't know. I don't know, like the seagull did in the book, right? Why are you flying higher? Why don't you hunt for food like the rest of us? He's saying, I don't know. I don't know. And then everybody's saying, why are you chopping the corners off? How will you steer? I don't know. I don't know. Why are you doing that? What's wrong with the rectangle? So I jumped it, and of course, the elliptical turns really fast. Like, whoa! So it seemed to slide off from above me.
Yeah.
Sideways. So I thought it needed more finish, more stabilizer. So those those things in the middle. And then we got rid of them. You were there when we got rid of those, weren't you?
Yep. Well, I think part of why we got rid of them is because pilots were getting better and they were flying more harness than they were just jerking steering toggles. So they could fly a more coordinated turn.
You're flying through the turn instead of just sliding the parachute off sideways.
Yeah. Yeah. And pulling a wingtip back, right?
You don't bury a toggle with a smooth elliptical like you did.
Yeah, honestly, I think the best thing that ever happened to parachute design, it's probably true of wingsuit as well, is the improvement in the skills of the pilots. That you can have a perfect design, you hand it to somebody who doesn't know how to use it, and they make it look like crap.
Yeah, well, blimey, it used to be big 170 porous things, and now it's little elliptical race cars.
Yeah, it's fun.
It's changed, hasn't it? Totally.
Yeah, well, of course.
Under canopy now, can't they? The swoopers.
Yeah.
Canopies and skydivers are docking now.
I know it. And something I wanted to bring up with you is the Arbird Pro seems to be the choice of a lot of people for XRW and for inverted XRW.
Yeah, yeah.
It's amazing.
I think I always use it a back lie. A big leg tends to lift your feet up because you can't bend when you're on your belly, you can bend your knees, right?
Yeah.
When you're back, your legs are out straight. So it's kind of always, unless you put your feet together, your legs are always lifting your feet up. So the Arbird Pro is a big arm, the Arbird leg is why it's called an Arbird, but it's really got a big arm and a big fat rib. And it's a symmetrical rib. It's not a flat bottom rib. It's symmetrical top and bottom for back flying, see? Something's right about it. It's a good story. You want to hear a story? You like stories or you want to talk shop?
Oh, no, man. Stories.
I was in Europe and they all said I needed a new Arbird. I had the Arbird, right? The first Arbird, which was from the Raptor. R for Raptor, the Raptor leg. So it depends the shape of the arm. Jeff did that. Jeff did the elbow, right? Came in and went down. So where was I going? So I come back. They said I need a new Arbird. So I made the Arbird Pro and jumped it with two tall, thin guys. And we got out of the plane and they were below me. And I thought, they'll get up, tall, thin guys in bigger suits. So they didn't. So I got on my back and so they came up on me. And then I got back on my belly and took off on them again. And then I said, they said they couldn't stay with it. I said, that's no good. I wanted the Arbird, which is middle of the road, right? So I took the arms off and made a smaller arm and that became the Foghead. and that was the Fargo. But I couldn't stop thinking about this Arbor Pro. So I, ages later, made another one. And James Ball, no, Spike, one or two, I made two. James Ball stole one and bought it. I took it because he's my boy. Took it back to Europe. And Spike, is my boy too, took one to England. They wouldn't, two times I made them and they took them. They wouldn't give them back. And James Ball lent someone base jumping and he wouldn't give it back. So I thought, well, there's something, you know. So we made some more. And it's certainly the most popular suit for all round. You could do whatever you want in the thing. You know, you can race or do XRW, which is rare that you can do the two, right? And back fly and all that. Yeah, and it's fairly easy to fly.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I was talking to Aspen last week, and he really likes it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He did some XRW with it off the mountain, off base XRW.
That's right. Yeah, that was phenomenal.
I got a little guy, Mo Valletto, I'm sure everybody knows.
Yes, yeah.
Little guy. He's a big guy, but he's a small person in physique.
Yeah.
But at the same time, full rate, in the pro as he did in the river. Which is a much bigger suit.
Wow.
It's a funny game, man.
Well, it's interesting. So design-wise, I've been playing around quite a lot with the Jedi that I've got. Because I like the Jedi. It's very easy to fly, right? There's no arm pressure at all. It's,
yeah.
It's relaxing.
Always like that.
But if you remember, I got out of control once on a low-altitude exit and spun out on my back.
When you're low, low exit. A nice one. Good timing.
And it was high airspeed as well. So it was a combination of several things, and it was my choice to leave the plane.
You rush your exit, maybe. At high airspeed, you're not ready for it.
I wasn't ready for it, and I just went ass over tea kettle because one wing inflated before the other one.
Yeah. The side door is quite a hard exit. If ever anyone's worried about base jumping and wingsuit, it's easy. You've got no in that side door, you've got all that blasted in one wing.
Yep.
Side of your body, tailgate's easier, of course, or a mountain.
Right, yeah, a mountain would do. Well,
if you're in a mountain, if you launch square, you stay square.
And yeah.
Head down, of course.
Yeah, it's your footwork, yeah.
You launch that chin up, or never. Well, there's a rock underneath you. If you look at it, you're going to hit it. So you forget that rock, and just chin up, and launch out, and off you go.
Yeah, yeah. Well, what I chose to do with the Jedi was I made the scoops a little bit more rigid, so they stick out nicely. I also created a cross port. So I cut a hole in the back of your suit and ran a tube channel of ZP under it's under the rig, under the BOC. So it goes from one side to the other. So if one wing inflates, the other one inflates.
Oh, arm to arm. Right. I thought you were going to say arm to leg.
No, I didn't do arm to arm because I wanted the arms to inflate first.
Evenly, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, why not?
So it works.
The leg would be the best. Combine the two.
I probably could do that.
There's an Italian doing it. Entone. I think Entone suits.
Yeah. Well, the other thing that I did, and I don't know that I can actually... Oh, I can screen share.
I need to try it.
All right, now can look at your screen, Tony. Can you see it?
Huh? Oh. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. What the hell? You're inflating your suit.
Yeah, now look at the tail.
Right.
Yeah. As I move my arms.
Uh-huh.
You see that?
It's going up and down.
Yeah. It's an elevator.
What's that? Did you install that? No, not G-string. It's you've got an elevator.
Yeah.
By pushing your arms forward, the tail went up.
Yeah, exactly.
Double elevator.
Yep. So it goes up to toggles that are in my hands, basically, down through the wing, across my legs. I had to put a little cutaway cable housing so it wouldn't rub. And then it's in a zero-piece sheath inside the back of the wing, sewn to the top surface panel, like a drawstring slider.
Yeah.
It works. I haven't jumped it yet.
This is not the one that made you go unstable in the low exit, is it?
No, it's not.
Okay.
No.
How was that when you jumped it?
Not yet.
You haven't jumped it?
No, not yet.
Oh, how long ago did you do the mod?
Oh, I did it last night.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah, there you go. I thought it was a year ago or something. You haven't had the guts to jump it.
Yep. Oh, there we go.
You jump this stuff. I used to be so nervous. No matter how small the change, I would be nervous in the plane.
I know.
You're 200 mile an hour through the air and things. Sometimes you get spins. Well, mate, pulled the parachutes because they couldn't stop the seat.
Yeah. So, I mean, what do you do? I mean, this is a question that I try to ask all my guests because I know that there's a lot of new skydivers out there, new wingsuit flyers that get the butterflies, you know, in their stomach to the point where they're not sure if they're going to screw things up because they're so nervous.
Mm-hmm. And that makes them nervous.
So what do you do? How do you stay cool enough to test jump a parachute, test jump a wingsuit, jump off a cliff?
Just breathe, relax, calm down. You'll be all right. Just listen to all the advice you've had and close your eyes and stay calm and relax. Everything's fine. Wingsuit is pretty easy. It's the easiest event, right?
It's easy.
But you can get a bit funny speed, you know. You get a wing over or something, you start barrel rolling.
Mm-hmm.
And you do something to fix it, and nothing happens. You think, I'm dead, this is it.
Uh-huh.
And then all of a sudden you stop. You did something else, naturally, without thinking. And you stop. Yeah.
So it's, I guess
it's... You will stop the spin or whatever.
So right.
Your belly, it will stop.
Well, along those lines, so what I've been taught, what little I've been taught formally about wingsuit flying is that if you get into some sort of instability, step one, arch. Yeah. And see if you can get rid of your wings a little bit, maybe bring your knees together some, bring your arms in, hug your rig maybe.
The pull position. You know the pull position you were taught? With your arms back on your hacky.
Yeah.
Your knees sticking out as much as you can.
Yeah.
I think that's the most popular one.
Yeah. So that I was taught number one, arch. If that doesn't work, number two, ball up in a cannonball. Hug your knees.
Then you're going to get in a ball is what I always wondered about.
Well, I haven't successfully.
I used to do style, right? We used to get really small to go faster.
Yeah.
So I don't want to get in a ball to spin. You're going to go, have you ever done that in an office chair where you spin up in an office chair and you get in a ball?
Yep.
Really fast. And you open up, you slow down again.
Right.
It's a dilemma, isn't it? Catch 22. You open up, you got your arms and wings out that's causing the spin to happen.
Yep.
You ball up, you're going to spin much faster. Now, I think the pull position, the belly out, arch, legs probably coming in together, arms back, the big banana.
Yes.
Whatever. And it's going to stop the spin.
So you'd lean towards that. Yeah, because what they tell me is it's your ABCs. Arch, if that doesn't work, ball up. If that doesn't work, canopy. That's the C.
Yeah. Well, yeah, two guys. We had one guy, Jason Brusson, who's a free guy. He's got these big arms. He said, look at my arms. He couldn't reach his handles. He was spinning so fast.
Ha! Wow.
Yeah, he used two hands to get his, what's he doing? I don't know, first he's cutting away. He was in the spin. I don't know what he needed two hands for. Maybe he went, I don't know. Maybe I got the story wrong. his arms. I couldn't reach my handles. And then maybe, I don't know why you wouldn't want to cut away though if you spin under a kind of
something. Yeah, I don't know. No idea.
Yeah, you can spin pretty fast. So remember, guy, national champion at the world meet, American national champion, had red eyes from the spin he pulled.
Yeah, so I did.
We're doing some serious speeds. Diving these wingsuits, and then you come out into the window, you're timing it so you hit the window, just maximum energy.
Wow.
And then you got, you know, a minute of time, whatever.
It's awesome. Yeah, well, there's Scott Callantine and Lurch, both that are flying your, now what's it called? Is it your Albatross?
He has an Albatross. Oh, God, it drives me nuts. Can you do this? Can you land the arms up? Oh, the arms up above your head. No, I'm not doing that. come up. And so he's got these grippers above his head right now.
Yeah.
He it drives me nuts. And I'm actually busy now to do that anymore.
It's working.
He said, yeah, he says it's great. He loves it so far out. Better than him saying that's a piece of shit.
Well, sometimes crazy is the answer.
I liked it. I don't know if I liked it better. It's kind of weird. It's on lower race car.
Well, have you watched Lurch's body position? Right? He flies like this.
He's trying to get rid of all that arm.
Yeah, instead of trying to put his arms behind him to stay down with smaller suits, his arms are still forward to tension the wing from his elbow down, but his hands point straight at the ground. Big M.
This wing, and just using the bit from the elbow in.
Yeah. It works. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, he docked on me in a much smaller suit numerous times.
Yeah, I have trouble with that. When I wear a big suit, I'm useless. I'm floating. I can't get down.
Yeah,
you can fly on your back. You get on your back and you can do anything.
Yeah.
Fast. And they could film you really badly in the smallest suit.
Yeah.
It's like two flyers on their backs.
Yeah.
Really fast.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay. Well, so another one of the good questions is, excuse me, about the starting wingsuiting. Right, there's lots of people out there that have thought about it and are justifiably concerned about safety and all that stuff. What do you think is a reasonable way to go I'm a regular skydiver. What should I do to work my way into wingsuit flying?
Right, once you get 200 jumps, you go see a school. And they have a bunch of suits for you, hopefully. And all the sizes is the hardest part. A school with no suits can't be a school, right? So they're going to have suits for you to try. Usually, you know, students have a basic suit, small suit.
Yeah.
And then, they'll coach you. You know, it's only 2 or 3 hours. It's not really intense. Third part. Teach you to look at the spot. You know, you're deciding where your spot is, you know. And, your first jump is just doing dummy pull. And you fly around in a C shape, just like, you know, landing the canopy, same sort of design out the plane.
Yeah.
And looking at the spot, looking at the drop zone or the spot you pick near the drop zone, pull to deploy. And then you just do dummy pulls.
That's really.
And then the instructor will go with you and he'll film you and he'll tell you what you did or didn't do. And then you might do one by yourself, and then you got to go to the school. It's a law, isn't it? To do that. Most drop zones don't go.
Have you heard of any of the schools actually using blowers or some way to create wind and inflation so they can practice pulling?
Europe, they do. Europe have one.
I do it.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
You do it? How do you do that?
Well, I've got a big blower fan. Have you ever seen they call it carpet blowers? Or you can't fly. You can't get off the ground. Yeah, exactly. It's a snail blower. Exactly. And so I'll get them on a creeper, that's enough. And then they get inflation on the whole suit and they get a sense of what it's going to feel like. And then they can do practice pulls.
How do you get in the leg wing?
You just have to scoot back on the creeper enough that that the air is going to your leg wing.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Works.
A special creeper.
Yeah.
You will come below the creeper.
Yep. Yeah. The air compresses underneath the creeper nicely, so it accelerates.
That's a great idea. Uh-huh.
Yeah, it works. Yeah. And I think it's a good way to, when somebody is terrified of the whole thing, is here, put a suit on.
Put it on. Time with the leaf blower. I put the leaf blower over the right arm and say practice the pull.
Yeah.
And move it away to where I think is the right distance. And I can put the blower right in the inlet where they can't reach back. But
yeah. Well, a shop vac will do it too. A shop vac. Just change it from suck to blow.
The leaf blower is a lot more powerful. I have three leaf blowers. I'm always looking for upgrading to big blowers.
Yeah.
I've had this thing in my head to build this wind tunnel. I thought getting on swamp buggy or something, you know, with a fella and set up a tunnel off of that. Mm-hmm. Bust it. And in my head, you go, $10,000, $10,000, $10,000, $10,000.
Yeah.
You're picking up a pencil. And funny, they've just done it in Europe.
I know. Yeah, Stockholm. So do you have plans to go over and fly in it?
I'm down halfway through a skydive. Now I'm ready to pull it. About $7,000. I don't think it's going to win time.
You get stronger.
I'm out of the plane to test this thing. And I zoom around, and by $7,000, I'm down. I'm thinking, all right, okay, there's the spot. I'm fly over there. But no, the arms are never hurting.
I guess that's the question is, you know, what else can we do to keep this exciting, you know, keep it fun? I think there's a lot more room.
I'm going to a competition tomorrow that's going to be fun in Paris Valley. It's wowed. It's a squirrel competition. Like, and then you get out of a tailgate, four people, and you bomb across the sky to the drop zone or a finish line, up in probably the drop zone.
Nice.
And you've got a speed event and a distance event.
Nice.
It's tomorrow.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, so now overall, I mean, is the Jedi still competitive? What's your most competitive suit for that kind of thing?
Jedi 3, second, well, me, Travis Mickle.
Yeah.
And he, I think, he's going to wear that tomorrow as well, or rather Friday starts. Tomorrow's Travis. The Nile, I think, for speed, but that's not been tested. That's been tested this weekend. It's exciting. That's why I do this stuff, you know. I'll just be more happy in the garden tree. But it is exciting to make a new suit. It's a race car, and you're taking it to a race. It's, you know, nervy. You know, you might come last. You might do well.
It's
a thrill. You know, garden is thrilling.
Yeah, not knowing, it's fun.
The garden, it's exercise.
I'm curious. Do you do yoga or anything for training?
Stretching, just stretching.
You're just straight up normal stretching?
Yeah, it's just stretching.
Well, I think
my wife Mary keeps talking about yoga.
Most wonderful lady ever.
Yes, Mary is too. Yeah, you know.
She's great.
She's in my own business. Everybody tells me I should do yoga. I'm stiff at all. My legs are just, I can just like touch my knees, like I don't touch the floor. And I was laughing aces. I'm at aces, right? All these guys are going to do back loops to stand there. And I'm competing against these kids. And I bend down and tap and pick something up off the floor, and I was so sore from these jumps. I hardly touch the floor, and I'm looking at them competing against these kids to back loops.
Yeah.
I laugh and laugh and laugh.
Well, yeah, I mean, I find because, you know, next month they turn 50, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I can feel, you know, elbows and knees.
50 is your prime, I think. 50, that's the start of approaching 60.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, and then in those 10 years, you definitely, if you sit and sew all day and you don't get out and garden, you will get fat and sore and stiff. I wish you do yoga and all that. You know, you can go to whatever you can do. But if you just sit and watch television and sew all day, or rather, sew all day and then come home and watch television.
Yep.
Age 50 plus.
Yeah, you get old. You see, one of the secret weapons that I was taught is you take a real hot bath with Epsom salts and then stretch, because you can't stretch cold muscles.
Yeah.
Right? It's a good one. See if it works. It also, I find it helps my just joint pain goes away. I do quite a bit of Reiki as well. It's very helpful. Not everybody is exposed to that one, but it works.
Especially not at the bar. If you got a bed off the bar.
There you go. If somebody says, I'll do yoga with you, Dad. That's funny. I don't know if you're watching the chat. It's quite amusing when people are popping in there.
After your video of dandelions.
Yeah, after my video of dandelions. Yeah, that's.
The dandelion is being carried by the dandelion. Did you see that in your?
Yeah, that's my background.
Yeah, the seed's being carried by the helicopter. That is fascinating. I've never thought about that before. I've never seen those stalks being carried by the wind.
So what else is new? What have you got going on that's like new product-wise, or, you know, you got the Nala, which is cool. I've heard nothing but positive things about your iBird.
Nothing but positive. I don't hear much about the iBird. Because it's mostly, you know, beginners.
Yep.
They never tell me much.
Well, you can reach up, right?
All the suits, you can do that. Depending on how tight you measure your forearm, how tight the suit fits around your forearm is controlling that. You know, if here's one I can show you. If your suit is tight here, you put your arm in the wrong way. Put your arm with the suit on the ground. Put your arm in the other way. If it jams there, the sleeve size, you will you probably get some rise. If it goes to there, you get your risers. If it only goes to there, you ain't getting nothing. You're lucky to lift your hands above your head, right?
Yeah.
So if the suit comes up here, you'll get your risers. And if it goes over your elbow, you'll get your toggles.
Nice.
Right? So it's all about this opening here. It's a wrist measurement, which isn't a wrist measurement. It's a forearm measurement here. Because then you're going to slide your arms out the sleeve.
Yeah.
Because on opening, I love just pushing on my risers. Yeah, because the parachute wants to go over there. I'm always pushing on the bloody thing.
Yeah.
So I put these big foams in a tighter sleeve or something, and I can't reach up. And it feels horrible when you got a suit that you can't reach above your head, and as you're deploying,
yeah,
it feels kind of naff, I think.
Yeah.
A lot of the race suits now are doing that. They're tightening the arms right up, and you can't reach up at all when you.
The stretchy material the iBird has that as well.
You can have it on pretty much any suit. iBird used to be standard on the iBird. Blimey, I don't even remember if I'm still doing that. I think I've gone to a regular fabric on the leading edge of the iBird now. But the neoprene leading edges, I love it. But you can have it tight, and you can still reach up because it's stretchy.
Yeah.
So I like that. I see the school suits put it on every suit now. They got a little circle of it here.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's interesting too. So that you've got some elongation.
Yeah, yeah, reaching up.
Cool.
Yeah, that's a nice thing. Cool.
And do you find it loses anything? Because I mean, the performance foam, right? The shaped foam. I know that Robbie likes that stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, what's your experience?
I do it too. It definitely stops your arms. And we were climbing out of helicopters at Aces. Oh, my arms! Those foams were so big. And you can't move, and you got to climb out of a helicopter with these two smoke brackets on your left foot and reach down and pop this smoke holding on to this helicopter. It was awful. I took them out. It was so much nicer when you take the phones out, and you're free and easy now, you know. But you got these phones in, you're like bloody Frankenstein.
Do you think you lose performance?
I didn't. I felt great. I like it better without the foams. To be honest, I jumped in the foams yesterday. It's why I jumped yesterday. Just test the suit for the foams.
Yeah.
Rather than in the bloody competition, because I get there at 2 in the morning and it starts at 8. On Friday morning, I thought Friday was a practice day, and it's not. So I wasn't going to get to practice. So I practiced yesterday with these foams, and they felt all right, so I'll go with them. But I'm sure I get better glide ratio without them. So I don't really know. I never do enough jumps anymore. I miss when I used to run to the plane, you know, and you get on every load.
Yeah.
I don't do that anymore.
Packing Kathy to take care of your rig and two rigs.
I'm bloody retiring. I'm going gardening.
Never going to happen.
Saying it. I can't retire. I don't know. You wonder if you're doing a good job by not doing enough jumps. Because every jump is a gem of information. And you can't believe you don't do more jumps.
Yeah.
You do go jump. And I don't feel like I'm doing any jumps.
Yeah.
There's always a bunch of reasons.
Well, you make the jumps that you make and try to take notes on what happened on the few jumps that you did make.
It's still working, you know. I'm still doing it. I'm still having lots of luck.
Yeah.
So I'll keep doing it until it all goes wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, hopefully you won't do that jump, but many do. That's the best way to quit, isn't it? You really want to quit. But, no, that's not going to happen. Because I'm a very careful person.
Well, we'll just keep, you keep paying attention to details. That's all we've ever done.
Exactly. You follow the rules. You do the same thing every jump. Right? You do this at this altitude. You do this. You prep every the same every time. You switch the cypress on exactly then.
Yeah.
I've seen cypress guys get told off for undoing the harness or whatever, for doing something different. You do it the same every time. Yeah? I zip up at this altitude. I look at the clouds on the way up,
mm-hmm.
and you're getting different height bearings from there because they don't mount on me as much. And I hate it if I didn't look at the windsock or something before I got in the plane. So every jump, you're walking out to the plane, you look at the windsock, you think, I've got an app where it tells me the upper winds. So I prep on where I'm going to open, I'm going up and over there, and I fly up wind and then come down wind. And you do all your stuff, every jump, the same, every jump. And
it's ritual. I think that's one of the answers to the fear to me is the rituals of checking the boxes, making sure that I've looked at everything the same way. And then my fear is no place to go because I have an answer to all the questions.
Yeah. Yeah. As soon as you rush to the plane for some reason.
Yeah.
And you're carrying your rig and you got to put it all on or the worst is your suit isn't on your harness and you got a 10-minute call and you're trying to rig the suit and you're rushing it and you get it wrong. My friend just landed with the plane because he did that. He rushed his suit on and rushed to the plane, put it on as everybody's getting on the plane. You put your leg straps on and then he got in the plane. It was on wrong. He rode the plane back now.
Good.
Which is obviously wiser than jumping the thing wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you can get in a spin with these things. It's an aeroplane. It's a 200-mile-an-hour aeroplane with giant control surfaces. Aeroplanes have little tiny control surfaces, right? The ailerons. We have these massive control surfaces. So you can get in a world of trouble at 200 mile an hour.
Yeah. But I think it's important that people are stay ready to stand down and their ego is not pushing them to go. You know, I mean, to me, that's what pushes me into all the bad situations I've been in is my ego, not wanting to take the hit. But.
Well, the worst one is base jumping. When you climb for hours and hours and hours, then you get to the exit and it gets cloudy. And you're waiting and waiting and waiting, and it might get dark. And you got to go back. And this climb was really bad coming up. And you got to go back in dark. And they talk about using cell phone lights. And you think, I don't want to go back and do that. I'm going to jump.
Yeah.
So you jump when they shouldn't jump, maybe?
Yeah.
And that's the worst one.
Bring a headlamp.
Huh?
Headlamps. It's not that complicated. They don't weigh much.
You got to jump with this stuff, though. Whatever you carry up, you got to jump with it.
Headlamps are small. The headlamps now have tremendous power. I mean, I live by a headlamp. We're always taking the kids hiking out after dark, climb a mountain, watch the sunset, and then we climb down the mountain in the dark. It's what we do regularly.
With
little babies, you know? And I have some backup batteries because they don't weigh much. And that allows us to do so much more. You know, we're not afraid of the dark because we're not in the dark. So I think that would, we'll add that to the, list of base jumping safety gear, a good headlamp, so that you don't feel pressured.
Yeah, man, you're climbing all day. You're so tired when you get to the top and they say you got to go climb back. Oh, my God, it's miserable. You fly, that's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, find a wingsuit, huh? That's fun.
Yep.
Looking back is hell, and your knees after that climb down. And you might have toe holds on the way up.
Yeah, it's
healing. There's no heel hole. You're healing. You're fucking your foot's there.
Yeah.
It's really hard coming back down with some of this stuff.
Yeah.
and reversing round and climbing back down. I'm not a mountain climber. That's the worst thing about base jumping, was the climbing.
Yeah.
I could handle the jumps. In fact, it was a relief to jump off this bloody mountain. I hated mountain climbing. And it's so scary. Sometimes you go, oh, don't die, don't die. You're hanging on to this shit.
Well, you know what happens.
You're not in your gear, you know. It's just a stash bag. It does. People fall off.
Yeah, well, Jonathan, right? We'll miss him.
Cut off an exit, they think. Yeah, champion. Or he got burbled. They didn't know. No one knows. He was like behind the freeway. He got off behind the freeway. And the freeway landed and he wasn't there. He'd hit the mountain just behind him. They either got burbled or he slipped on exit or tripped over or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, there's 100 ways to die, eh?
Yeah, but you know, there's 100 ways to survive those things if you prevent it. If you learn from the people who died, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Talk to the people that are still alive. The stories of why they're still alive.
That's what casual chat's all about, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you've managed to stay alive. I mean, you've thrown your body at the planet many, many thousands of times.
Yeah.
For 40 years or so, right?
Right. It's only luck once. One accident I had was luck I didn't die.
Yeah.
The rest of the time, it's been mostly being careful.
There you go. Well, hopefully you'll have many, many more. You know, there's a lot of people.
You got to sew a rig to a wingsuit and make a harness on a harness machine, and then you put it all on, you go jump off a mountain. And if that's being careful, I don't know. But I survived that, but I don't know if someone would say that was being careful. But who else are you going to get to jump this thing?
Well, I agree. I do all my cutting edge test jumping myself, and it's scary. And yet, if guys like us don't explore the possibilities, you know, if you don't jump that first sit suit or the first wingsuit or elliptical or whatever, then there's no progress. And so the sport stagnates at its current level of safety. Mm-hmm. So I think for the good of the sport, there has to be a little bit of risk.
Yeah, you have to test it to know. I use Travis more and more and more. As I say, I don't do enough jumps for testing. I'm starting to use other people. I got a good Aussie. I got Travis. Chris Burns in Australia was fifth at the World Meet. I got Travis. I make them. Igor is good in California. Just got a job with Facebook. And I was going to go to Facebook with him and get a Facebook pic. next week. Tomorrow. I'm going to see him tomorrow in Paris Valley. I was supposed to go to San Francisco with him. We go to Silicon Valley and visit Facebook.
Oh, nice.
I start making suits for these guys because they do the jumps. They jump, jump, jump. And they'll have more opinions than me doing one jump.
Yeah.
Well, I do the one jump and an opinion. I form an opinion after just 1 minute.
Yeah. Not always correct. Yeah.
I do this and do that. I have a pretty good guessy because I've done that, right? I added a half inch. But I go jump it, and I feel how that half inch feels. And you feel it. That's what I hate about parachutes. You spend all week making a bloody parachute, and you didn't notice the difference. The prototype, you make changes with the plastic. Remember before we got Gyro's machine?
Yeah.
You change in plastic.
Yeah.
You make a suit, a parachute, and you spend a week making that, and you didn't see the difference. But a wingsuit, you make the smallest change, and you notice it immediately. You don't notice that, the changes you make to that.
Yeah.
You get a video. Get someone to film you when you jump your elevators.
I was going to send it to you.
Igor, send it to Igor. He'll jump anything. He jumps.
How tall is he?
You can go way past the feet and up and put the iBird leg on it, my smallest student suit leg on this suit, right? But the arm wing went past your feet, way wider than your feet. This is your foot. It went way out here, way past to a point, 8 inches past your feet, and then up inside the foot, up into an eyebird leg. So it's like a swift.
Yes.
A swallow or a swift, shape, right, at the back. So Travis jumped, I don't know, her knee at the time, and Travis jumped it and said he didn't like it. I threw it in the corner, and this Igor chap from Belarus is an American living in California now. He finds it in the corner, and goes, oh, look at this, look at this. We made a cartoon of it. And he wants to try it. He loves it. He loves it. Oh, all right. There we go. He takes it on this last space trip I just did. Me and him go together, actually. He's testing it because we're going to go to the world based race, and I'm going to go to China. I was going to go to China this last China race, which was the height of my base career, this China race.
Yeah.
And I was going to do it again, but I did this base thing and I didn't like it. I did some gorgeous jumps, but it's just not for me, right? I was stressed out after this Altissimo Nego, this giant climb where you're going down these big ropes. I just took my gloves out of my bag, my hands are killing me, and you got to climb around this bowl and holding on to grass. Oh, my God, yeah. I got to the exit point. Everybody was there waiting, all these young guys.
Yeah.
And I got to go, and they start dressing and going. There's a load of us. It's like 15 of us did this. And they're all gone. This French guy, Rock Manuit, says, can I film you? I said, yeah, sure. So I got up to get dressed and I had to sit down again. My vision was all blurry, right? And I had to rest and just relax. Okay, here we go. Get ready again. Oh, got to sit down again. I said, I'm sorry. And here's that thing. I ain't going back there. I'm not going to go back through that awful climbing. I'm going to get this together. And relax, whatever you need to do. And eventually he got together and jumped and he filmed me. And it's a gorgeous jump over Lake Garda, down the road from Brentno, where we normally jump. And it was lovely and all that, but it's just not for me. I don't like the climbing, you know. I like walking out to the plane. It's a bit of a rough ride sometimes, isn't it? For 20 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And then you jump out and fly around the sky and land right there, right? And you pack right there. You don't have to have a 4-hour climb after the tour. Yeah.
Easier to abort as well. Much easier to pull.
I'm too old for that. Why am I talking about base jumping?
Because it's interesting. I mean, yeah,
It was very interesting. I loved it. I totally loved it. I loved doing Europe. We did 4 summers of going to Europe for 4 months. Base jumping, touring around in a camper van. Norway, Switzerland, Italy, France, brilliant, loved it. Paragliding, base jumping, total another world. Switzerland and Norway, gorgeous, you know. Driving a camper van, me and Mary, and these campgrounds. Brilliant, loved it. But the mountain climbing, and I got all these pros. Come with us. It's been great. Oh, yeah. I'm not very good at climbing. Oh, you'll be all right, because they don't have any trouble with it. But you get up there, this old fart that sews all day. How do you keep talking me into this crap? I climbed the Eiger, though. You know, afterwards you go, well, I climbed the Eiger.
Yeah, exactly.
I love the bloody thing.
Yeah.
And my daughter made a video of it. Dean Potter climbed up backwards, filming with his iPhone on a short line, carrying my gear bag.
Carrying your gear bag?
Yeah, he carried my. I said, I ain't going to do it. He said, I'll carry your gear. Him and Sean Lewis taking turns carrying my gear. And we climbed the Eiger. And I'm saying the whole time, what the fuck? How do you guys talk me into this shit? This is like the 15th time. But, you're saying, why do I let you guys talk me into this? These guys say,
yeah.
The problem, the climb is mounting to jump up it for this 1-minute skydive or 2 minutes sometimes. You've got half a day's climb. But they love it. But I don't know if I do. So anyway.
Jump out of planes then. It's all right.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. 2 parachutes.
I'm not even very good at that anymore. I seem to be losing it fast.
Well, you do what you can do.
I'm going to go again tomorrow. Right, try one more time. I came, what was I, 17th or something at the World Meet. That wasn't bad.
Not bad at all.
Did all right, aces the second year. So I'm still sort of there, but it's going away. It's going away fast. I'm not 19, you know.
Well, I mean, to me, with all of this stuff, when you're younger, it's about the numbers, you know. Am I on the podium? Where do I place in that? And now for me, it's more about the experience, the emotional experience of just, you know, the beauty of flight, of being part of something that's going on, and, you know, playing with my friends in the sky, as Olaf Zipser nicely said, to be swimming in the ocean of air. Or the ocean of gas, he called it.
Yeah, those are atmospheric dolphins, aren't they? We like dolphins in the sky.
Yeah, I like that. And then takes the quantitative out, and you focus on the quantity.
Yeah, it's so beautiful. They're looking above the clouds. When you go above the clouds, isn't it? You know, after 40 years, you still look at that plane and think, look at that. That is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen.
Yep.
The sky is just so beautiful. And from the ground, you look up at it. Yep. The wingsuit, you go, whoa, like that. You know, that'd be fun to fly around there.
Yeah.
And sometimes in the summer here, I was going to do a summer camp where you would go up in the clouds. In August here, your clouds go from 3 or 4 grand or 2 grand, whatever, all the way to 13 grand. And the pilots take you over. After the tandems go, the plane would fly you over and you fly a cloud all the way down.
Yeah.
The clouds are so much fun. You know, they don't hurt like mountains when you hit them.
Well, there you go. And of course, now we've got GPSs. Have you got one? Like there's that little Garmin. I love it.
Fly sites, yeah.
It's fantastic. Oh, the flight site, but that does, I mean, as far as your location.
Yeah, yeah. It'll tell me location. It'll tell me navigation.
Has it? I haven't got one.
Yeah, you gotta have it. It talks to me the whole jump. It's telling me if I set it, I set it for navigation, which is beep, 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 you know, as you turn towards the drop zone. Or you can set it for vertical speed, horizontal speed, or glide ratio. And it's telling you 53, 54. And it's going as you go in 56, 57, 58, 59, the beeps go up and the beeps go down as well as you're telling your number in between the beeps.
Yeah.
That's the name. And they talk to us in the dive as well. And it'll go quiet and it'll say 3, 2, 1, beep, which is the flare for the window. And then it talks to you about your whatever it is you've set it for. In PPC, you got time, distance, speed. So you would set it for, you know, time. It's telling you how fast you're falling vertically.
Yeah.
So that makes you flare and you flare and you flare, and then suddenly you stall the bloody thing. And your numbers get, so that's what training is, you know, that you know. Here we go. Don't go any slower than this. You're going to bloody stall it. Am I getting too relaxed here?
Hey, it's casual chat, right?
Yeah, I'm trying to sit forward. I thought my chin looks big sitting like this. I better sit.
Well, that's the down
belly. I so all day. Belly from crouched over a bloody sewing machine. So thing forward, my chin looks tight.
Well, they
stay. So belly. So I thought I had to sit back.
Well, make yourself comfortable. We have to wrap up here anyway. I'm home alone for the next, I've been doing the single dad thing. Laura is off in the Grand Canyon paddling the Colorado River for two weeks.
Why didn't you both go with her?
Well, who's going to watch the babies?
Both of you go. Oh, you got three. That's right. You got two.
I've got two boys, but yeah, Laura's doing the adventure this time.
Nice.
I get plenty. I get lots of adventures.
Mary's away with her family in Montana.
Oh, lovely. Mm-hmm. Playing with horses, no doubt.
Yes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's awesome.
And a mum.
Love it. Love it. Cool. Well, but I want to thank you. Firstly, for you know, facing up to the world here in a live format, being on casual chat. But more than that, I want to thank you for all you've done for the sport skydiving. Really.
Thank you very much. It's been fun. I've just been following my nose. It was effortless, really, you know. Kind of hard work sometimes, but not really. Mostly effortless and fun. And you guys are mostly making a living, right? You know, you make gear bags.
Yeah.
You go out and you sort of show people your gear bag. You're trying to make sales and have fun and not rip anybody off. Do everybody good.
Yeah.
And make it better. You're always trying to make it better. Just bloody every year you got to make it better. It's already the best thing in the world. And next year you're going to make it better. That's the thing about wingsuits all the time.
Yeah.
Make it better than last year.
Well,
really hard. Last year you thought it was the best thing in the world. But now you've got to make the best thing in the world every 6 months now with wingsuits.
Gives you a reason to get out of bed.
Right. Oh, yeah. Sunday mornings, I can stay in bed, man. Facebook, internet, whatever, email. book, you know, and then go garden. Oh, I love it. Play golf. I'm doing some really good golf. Here's one at 63. I've been playing this course since I was 40. I started when I was 40. And I just had my best games, my best drives and other games, but 279s I got. First time I've got 279s back to back.
Yep.
And I'm out driving. I'm going past the 150 mark on a par 5. Stuff like that. That I've played this hole 1,000 times and I've never done that. I've never done that. You know what I mean? At 63, you can still do it. And it's fascinating. Not with skydiving, maybe, but with golf, I'm doing it.
There you go. Long as you're having fun.
Yeah, right. Little things like that give you a little boost, you know, a little bit boost your ego. It's always nice, isn't it?
Boost the joy level, you know? To me, the experience of having fun has nothing to do with my ego. It's just I'm playing. You know?
You're enjoying it, right? You're fun. You're jumping up and down. You got a birdie. Woo-hoo! On a par 3, that's $1 for the hole. Unless you get a birdie, then it's $2. And you get a birdie. Yes, even though you don't collect from your buddies, you just want $2.
Yeah.
You and you.
It's awesome. It's awesome. Yeah. Well, I think that's one of a good message to send to the skydiving world is keep having fun.
Yeah.
You know, so that this can still be interesting. It doesn't have to be about the numbers. It doesn't have to be about, you know, beating other people. I mean, it can be if you want, but I think what keeps me in the game, you know, this is my 31 years of jumping, is to continually giggle. You know, continually invent new things and have a joyful time with my friends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you're having fun with it, the guys that just there to beat other people, like the teams, they do 1,500 jumps a year to beat everybody. They disappear after that year or something, and they're gone.
Yeah,
just having fun with it is the name of the game for sure.
It is
a bit of this, a little bit of that. People say, "Oh, they got to keep doing four way, or they got to keep doing this one event to get good at it," but just do all events and have a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And don't get too serious about it.
There it is. Don't get too serious. Right on. Well, this has been a pleasure with Tony Uragallo. Thank you so much for joining us on Casual Chat. And, of course, if you want to find Tony on the web, was it tonysuits.com probably?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is that your primary website? But, yeah, some of the best wingsuits ever built and continually moving forward, which is...
Yeah, well, I hope so.
Right on. Cool. All right. Have a great night, Tony.
Yeah, see you too, buddy.
Silver car with a borrowed guitar, ready to travel so far.